I welcome you to take your Bible with me and turn to Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, the first book of the New Testament, the first of the four Gospels, right near the end of it, Matthew chapter 26. Hopefully you already have that message outline, and then don't forget some communion supplies also. And tonight, for Good Friday, we remember the one who died in our place, in Jesus our King, crucified in our place for forgiveness of sins. And Palm Sunday, we started this short Easter resurrection series with saying yes to Jesus and saying yes to Jesus' recognition with that triumphal entry into Jerusalem. But as we prepare now in just a couple days to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, we remember that we come to the joy of Easter through the suffering and the sadness and the horror of the cross. And we come tonight to the foot of the cross of Jesus and remembering his great sacrifice for us. He died in my place and he died in your place for forgiveness of sins. And when we look at this extended passage in Matthew, Matthew gives us a lot of detail, and we're going to read good chunks of scripture together. What did Jesus experience as he suffered for us? And what should we remember? Because Good Friday, I think, is about remembering. And so is the Lord's table as we celebrate together near the end of our time. And so we say yes to crucifixion remembrance. And we remember our shared sinfulness. And we're going to jump into the narrative in Matthew 26, starting in verse 36. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, right there. That's where we're jumping in. And we remember our shared sinfulness as we look back and we reflect on the sinful and foolish behavior of the disciples. It's easy for us to see that and say, wow, I would have done it so much different. Yet as we see their sinfulness, we're and their sad responses to what Jesus experienced, and quite frankly, their sinful responses to what Jesus experienced. It's easy for us to point fingers, but then we're really pointing at ourselves as well. And so as we see their indifference and their betrayal and their denial, we also can look at ourselves and say, you know what? When we remember the crucifixion, we remember our shared sinfulness. So we admit indifference, that sometimes we're indifferent to Jesus' suffering. And certainly we see that with the disciples. Let's jump in, verse 36. Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. And he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with them, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. And then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. That's a reasonable request. And going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it's possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. And then he returned to his disciples and he found them. We know the story. They're sleeping. Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour, he asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He's so kind, even in this dark time. And he went away a second time and prayed, my Father, if it is possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. And when he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. So when we reflect on the crucifixion and we remember shared sinfulness, and we're called to admit the indifference of the disciples here, but also ours. We also admit betrayal, and we know what's coming next if we're students of the Gospels. Verse 47, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them, the one I kiss is the man, arrest him. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, greetings, Rabbi, and kissed him. What a way to betray him. And Jesus replied, do what you came for, friend. Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. So our shared sinfulness also includes not just indifference, but at times like this, betrayal, betraying Jesus himself. And then also desertion. We say, well, hey, no, Judas was the bad guy. That's not me. But this next one catches all of us where we admit desertion. Verse 51. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword and drew it out and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Put your sword back in its place, Jesus said to him, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But then how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way? In that hour, Jesus said to the crowd, am I leading rebellion that you've come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled. And catch it, then all the disciples deserted him and fled. So we start catching not just the disciples, and when we look at them and say, wow, they really blew it, we point finger back at ourselves as well, and we catch this sense. We all couldn't experience these events with Jesus. But in our more reflective moments, we realize we have this shared sinfulness back then and today. Jump down with me in the narrative to verse 69. We also admit denial. So indifference, betrayal, desertion, denial. Now, Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him, and Jesus is being tried, and Peter's there. He fled, then comes back, and Jesus had already told him that he'd deny him, and Peter said that would just never happen. So a little servant girl came to him. You were with Jesus of Galilee, she said, verse 70, but he denied it before them all. I don't know what you're talking about, he said. Then he went out to the gateway where another servant girl saw him, and he said to the people there, this fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth, and he denied it again with an oath. I don't know the man. And after a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, surely you're one of them. Your accent gives you away. Then he began to call down curses, and he swore to them, I don't know the man. And immediately a rooster crowed. And then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. And he went out and wept bitterly. See, we remember the crucifixion and the events leading up to it, and we catch and we experience and we reflect on our shared sinfulness, our indifference, betrayal, desertion, denial. And we remember the crucifixion, we have to ask a question. Do you admit our guilt? Do I admit my guilt before the Lord? Go back up with me to verse 57 of chapter 26 now, because we not only remember our shared sinfulness, but we remember his suffering sacrifice. What did his sacrifice look like? It hurt a lot. It was painful. Emotionally, physically, the very core of his being, Jesus was hurting. Let's look at verse 57 of chapter 26 and reflect on his unjust treatment. Jesus was not treated well. That's not exactly a surprise. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance right up to the courtyard of the high priest, and he entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. And the chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so they could put him to death. But they did not find any, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward and declared, this fellow said, I'm able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days. And then the high priest stood up and said to Jesus, are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you? But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said to him, I charge you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God. Well, you have said so, Jesus replied. But I say to all of you, from now on you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest tore his clothes and said he'd spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you've heard the blasphemy. What do you think? He's worthy of death, they answered. And then they spit in his face and they struck him with their fists, and others slapped him and said, prophesy to us, Messiah, who hit you? See, when we remember the crucifixion, we remember the suffering sacrifice of our Lord and Savior, and we reflect and we think about his unjust treatment. But also we recollect his painful, very painful suffering. Jump down with me to chapter 27 and in verse 33. Verse 33 of chapter 27. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And there they offered Jesus wine to drink and mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. And above his head, they placed the written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. And two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. Well, he saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, for he said, I am the Son of God. And in the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. See, when we remember the suffering sacrifice, we remember his painful suffering. Crucifixion was intentionally designed to be intense and ongoing and extremely painful. And in the midst of that pain, he's mocked and made fun of. Recollect his painful suffering. Also recollect and recognize his lonely separation. He's dying alone. There's people around, but there aren't people there with him, right? That are connecting with him. We see a few scenes of that, of intimacy with John and Mary. But the main separation that Jesus experiences is with our triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And God the Father turns away. And Jesus, for the first and last time in eternity, is separate from God his Father. Verse 45, recognize his lonely separation. From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, and translated, it means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And when some of those standing there heard this, they said, he's calling Elijah. And immediately one of them ran and got a sponge, and he filled it with wine vinegar and put it on a staff and offered it to Jesus to drink. And the rest said, now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. See, Jesus is separate from God the Father as he takes the weight of the sin of the world, mine and yours, on himself. And he is in complete anguish, and then he dies. And he quotes from Scripture, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? So we remember on Good Friday the suffering sacrifice of Jesus, and we're called to reflect on our guilt, and do you admit your guilt, but also recall his anguish on our behalf. Jesus hurt for us. Well, what does all this mean? Are we just meant to kind of feel bad and move on? What's this all about? Well, the third thing on your outlines and in your Bible, we're going to jump back up in Scripture now to Matthew 26. Let's go back up to verse 26 of Matthew 26, because Jesus explains while they're celebrating the Passover. And that's when he took the cup and he took the bread. And I encourage you to do that with me. Have the cup with you and have the bread with you as we celebrate communion together. But this final thing is remembering substitutionary significance. And that's that. Substitutionary is not a word we use every day. but Jesus substituted himself for us. So there's this substitutionary atonement. Jesus took our place, he took my place, and he took your place. And there's significance to that, and Jesus explains it. And in verse 26 of Matthew 26, they're celebrating the Passover, and this is before the events we just described in Scripture, and Jesus is going to go to Gethsemane and then be arrested there, go through the trials and crucifixion. But he explains. So during that eating time, Jesus took the bread, in verse 26, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body." Let's do that. Matthew goes on in verse 27, then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and he said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," and here's the significance, "for the forgiveness of sins." So we reflect on our sinfulness, and we remember the suffering sacrifice, but we want to catch that substitution significance. Jesus took our place, and the significance of his substitution on our behalf, it's for forgiveness of sins. So we receive Jesus to experience forgiveness. We take Jesus in, like we're doing now, to experience forgiveness. Please partake with me. Jesus concludes their Passover time. It's not all sadness. Receiving Jesus is joy. He was poured out for us. And so we receive Jesus. We take Jesus in, just like we took that bread and that cup in. We receive Jesus to experience forgiveness. And then Jesus gives us anticipation. And I put this on your outline. Anticipate joy with Jesus. And so Jesus goes on in that Passover, in that communion time. He says, "I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." See, we don't just look back. Looking back to the cross points us to that anticipation of joy, not just guilt, not just sorrow. See, we're forgiven. Jesus offered himself for forgiveness of sins. So we anticipate, we look ahead, and we get to do that as in just a few days with Resurrection Sunday, but we even look past the resurrection, past now and into eternity, and there will come a time when Jesus will celebrate that Passover, that communion again, and it will be when we're with him in his Father's kingdom. No more guilt, no more pain, no more suffering, no more denial, no more desertion. And we anticipate this sense of joy in the presence of our Savior. Put this all together. Do I trust his salvation plan? Do I trust in his substitution? Do I trust in what God the Father provided through his Son, Jesus Christ, for forgiveness of sins? Do I trust his salvation plan? Speaking simply, do I trust Jesus? See? Do I trust Jesus? Do you trust Jesus for forgiveness of sins? He took our place. Let's pray. Father, thank you. We understand our shared sinfulness. We see and reflect on the suffering sacrifice of our Savior. And we want to catch that substitutionary significance that Jesus took our place. And we can receive, we can take Jesus in through faith by your gracious act, and we're forgiven. And we can experience a new sense of joy and relationship with you now, and we can look ahead to that into eternity when we celebrate in our Father's kingdom with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. himself. And so we anticipate the joy we experience now, but we really look ahead. And we look ahead to Easter together, Resurrection Sunday. But then we jump past today and into eternity, where we anticipate joy with Jesus. Thank you. Amen. Don't go away. Grace is going to sing for us a wonderful song, wonderfully appropriate for Good Friday, called Blessed Redeemer.